a conviction of the position of God that, don't worry, we can still take this place. He faithfully served Moses. The part that struck me was when he found there were people who were not prophets, who were prophesying in the camp. And they went to tell Moses, look at these people, they are not prophets, they are prophesying. You know what Moses said? He said, enviest thou for my sake? Enviest thou for my sake? That will tell you the level of loyalty and faithfulness that he had towards his boss. But you know, throughout, when the mantle fell upon him, he won many battles. Everything that was ordained to be done, every promise of God, the division of, you know, everything concerning all the tribes, he accomplished to the letter. There was no compromise at all. So when he stood to say, as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord, you will look at his life and say, no, this man is worthy to be followed. Are you? Question number one, are you? Can people listen to you and say, yes, no, I will follow your God. No, I will serve your God. No, I will not turn my back on the one that has helped us this far. The second thing I want us to talk about is from that theme that talked about the word choose, which means there is a responsibility for you and I. The decision to either accept or reject rests with you and I. As powerful as God is, as awesome as he is, as sovereign as he is, as mighty as he is, he left something for us, a free will. Most times you will not go against that free will. The ability to choose a path for yourself. And then you will find in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19, if we can quickly read it, where he laid out before the children of Israel, chapter 30, verse 19. Yes. And it says, I call heaven and earth to record this day against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both thou and thy seed may live. He was the one admonishing us. You understand the question of us. Choose life. He laid before us what the options are. But you know, for every choice, every decision, there is a consequence. Am I right? That consequence is what you will answer to. That's why there is heaven, and that's why there is hell. Even the decision to give your life to Christ, you do what? Believe in your heart and confess with your mouth. It still rests with you. So to serve with all your heart and mind is still within your own ability. If you don't, it's nobody's fault too. It's you that have decided that God that you serve is not worthy of your service. Examples abound. Eve taking the fruit. Adam eating the fruit. Cain, the offering that he brought and killing Abel. Abel, the sacrifice that he brought. All this, the whole of the scriptures is replete with people who made choices, because that's what he's giving us to do. And the consequences of those choices, David and Bathsheba, the consequences of those choices, we must be ready to bear. So there are consequences for that which we'll do. The third thing is the analogy of soldiers. You know, the Bible uses analogies a lot to try and explain things that are not very clear, using things that we understand and are clear. To help us understand what the soldier of Christ is, he tries to use the earthly soldier, the regular soldier, so that we can understand what our responsibilities and roles are, what is expected of us. Now, many years ago, I'm sure I even watched it in a black and white TV. I watched a documentary, BBC documentary, by Frederick Forsyth, a writer, British writer, Frederick Forsyth. 12-part series. If I can get it, I will still go and buy that thing. You know, in black and white, that will tell you how many years. It was on soldiers. It started from many years, centuries, from the early man. You understand? Why men fight. And the instruments of war, you know, from stone to bows and arrows to guns to the machine guns to the nuclear, everything, he traced it. He traced the mindset, the training of soldiers. He traced so many things, starting from the wars of the 18 something between Britain and France. And they were with pictures, with interviews for those who were participants in the war, sharing their experiences. And, you know, from up to the Prussian Wars, to the First World War, to the Second World War, to the, which one now? The Korean War, then to the Vietnam War, to our own war, to the Arab-Israeli War. You understand? So it didn't take the Gulf War, the first and the second, because it was much earlier than those particular wars. But he traced the history and the challenges that soldiers faced. He opened my eye to so many things. You know what? From then, the instruments of war has transformed from bows and arrows to chariots, to horses, to the Roman, you understand? To guns, to machine guns, to all sorts of instruments. But you know something that has not changed? The mentality of the warrior. All through history, the mentality of the warrior has not changed. Whether from, even you find in the Second World, when they will interview those who are in the Allied side or those who are in the German side, the mentality was the same. So for us as soldiers of Christ, things like discipline, there's no compromise about discipline. There's no compromise about obedience. That's why they say obedience is you understand? Obey the last order. You run away from the battlefront to abandon your people is death. You understand? It is clear. And when you now wonder that we are called soldiers of Christ, these are people who are fighting under a flag. The decision to give their life for that flag is taken the day they sign up. So you ask yourself, they're fighting for a flag. But we're fighting for the King of Kings. Our task is far more laudable. But are we as dedicated? There's something I found out there. Drills. That's why you find that in training and in teaching the soldiers, you find that how to use their guns, that they can disassemble it and assemble it even with their eyes closed. Abi, there are things that they teach them to do. You know why? So that when they get to the battlefront, they are not thinking again. It's completely automatic. The drills, our own instrument, is the word of God. Abi, the drills for us to be proficient in it, study to show yourself approved, so that when the time for battle comes, it comes to you straight. So different wars, different challenges. That analogy is to help us understand what we require as faithful servants. So the text, like I said, is Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to the end. But I want us to read the second one. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1 to 2. It says, let a man so account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man do be done what? Be found faithful. Are you? The call to service is for all believers. Is for all of us. All of us is for all believers. That's why that cliche that we are saved to serve is true. It's true, sir. It's true, ma. We are all saved to serve. If the text in Romans chapter 12, verse 4 and 5, compares the body of Christ to the body, the human body. And it says we have many members in one body. All members have not the same office. So we being many are one body in Christ, and every one member one of another. There are many giftings, many different abilities, many things. The hand can't do what the eye will do. So what you can do, I can't. I see those who are able to pray for hours, and I say, you know, there are gifts, there are abilities, but they are meant for a purpose. And we are meant to all function together to achieve that common purpose for God. You know, service must come from a deep personal relationship. Like in Joshua that we described, it must come from a deep personal relationship with Jesus. So that you serve him out of love, not out of duty. Not out of duty. Let me do this. I need to do this. I need to be there in church. You can be seated and your mind is far away. You can be praying, but there is bitterness in your heart. You can be doing things, but your spirit is coming out of what? Out of a heart that is not aligned with Jesus. In Malachi chapter 1, God was talking to priest whose service he said was not acceptable to him. Malachi chapter 1, because they were serving God out of duty, not out of love. 12 to 14, he says, but you have profaned it, in that you say the table of the Lord is polluted, and the fruit thereof, even his meat, is contemptible. You also say, behold, what a weariness is it, and you have snuffed at it, that the Lord of hosts, and ye brought that which was torn, and the lame, and the sick. Thus you brought an offering. Should I accept this of your hand, saith the Lord? What are you bringing to him? Is it worthy of the kind of service that we are rendering? So it should be out of love, not out of duty. Service to God, a writer said, it's not merely external and outward. He said it is heart and soul, not fits and starts, but constant, thorough, practical, and universal subservience to the Most High. That, for me, explain. He says it is thorough, it is practical, and universal subservience in every area of your life, complete and total subservience to the Most High. Said true service is loving Jesus to the point of death. And that's the truth. If you look at the lives of the apostles and missionaries, all these things that we're hearing, you must love God to that point. Like the soldier, they are signed up for death. I'm told that when they say, when you in NDA or any of those places, any of those military training points, once you come and you say you want to be a soldier, you sign off your life, your name is gone, you are given a number. Because when you die, they'll say, cadet so-so-so and so is gone, Abi. Because you've signed off your life to it. Are we aware of that? Every believer in the body of Christ, like I said earlier, is endowed with gifts. Gifts to serve others and to bring praise to the name of Jesus. Bring gifts to serve others and to bring praise to the name of Jesus. And then, service to God, brethren, must be on his terms. Service to God must be on his terms. We are not volunteers. We are not meant to be volunteers. Service to God must be on his terms. Can you imagine you employing a clerk? And you set out what the clerk is meant to do. Resume at 8, close at 5, do this ledger, go to this place, accomplish this in 1 month, do this one, and then I will pay you your salary. Then you will get promotion, you will get the perks of office. Am I right? And the man says, yes, I accept. Very beautiful. Thank you. But I will resume at 9. I'm coming from Arepo, Magboro. So the long bridge is not very good. So I'm shifting my resumption to 9 or 10. You know, my child is this. So I will close early so that I can meet them at home. What do you think will happen? It will be sacked, Abby. Exactly. That's what we are doing. That's what we are doing to God. We are serving him on our terms. You understand? We are serving him on our terms. At our convenience. Is that faithful service? We're serving him on our terms. If you will sack such a clerk or such an employee, what do you think will happen to you and I if you were to truly check our records? So we're not volunteers. Volunteers are the ones who can leave at any time. I'm volunteering to clean the toilet in a school or in a hospital. Once it's 12, I have an appointment, so I couldn't make it today. They will look for somebody else, Abby. But if your job is to be there at all times to make sure that that place is clean, would you have an excuse? I don't think so. Let's look at that, Luke chapter 17. And we'll read 7 to 10. He said, but which of you, having a servant plowing or feeding cattle, will say unto him by and by, when he's come from the field, go and sit down to meat, and will not rather say unto him, make ready wherewith I may sup, and guard thyself, and serve me till I have eaten and drunken. Afterwards, thou shalt eat and drink. Abi? He said, doth he thank the servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I said, I trow not. So likewise, when you shall have done all those things which are commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants. We have done that which was our duty to do. So all those ones that I'm not recognized, nobody checked me. I'm not, If your service is to him, your eyes are on him alone, that I'm doing that which he has called me to do. Even if nobody recognizes or sees, as long as he knows, that's enough for us. That should be enough for us. So we must also not serve self. That's another thing. I know that, times are interesting times. Recession or no recession, depression or no, things at times are tough. They are not tough, they are getting better. And I stand with my brother, I say, by December, this economy will thrum. Yeah. Prophet Ajiboye, God bless you, sir. So the needs for self is so there. Accommodation, rent, feeding. And then sometimes we use the service to God to feather our nest. Because of that tomorrow we are afraid of. You make compromises because of your immediate needs. Your pockets, your stomach. But then we should check ourselves. We should ask ourselves. Look at ourselves. The essence of this message is for us to just sit down and introspect and say, how am I? So what are the qualities of these faithful servants that we can look at, that we can emulate? Number one, the faithful servant must be broken. The faithful servant must be broken. Must be broken. There is no question of self. Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. You see, for it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. That's what you are. You're just an instrument in his hands. So you must be completely broken, completely yielded. humility, because when you understand that you are nothing before him, and that you are dependent, your life, your breath is dependent on him, then you understand that you are just for what? For his good pleasure. The faithful servant must be willing to surrender all to Jesus. Everything. Can we look at Acts chapter 9, verse 63? Sorry, chapter 9, verse 6. Where did he get 63? It's Acts 9, 6. He says, as he journeyed, he came to the... Acts chapter 9. Yes, let's read from verse... Okay, I will take it from... It was Saul asking, what would you have me do? Verse 6. And trembling and astonished, Lord, what would you have me to do? And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the city, and it shall be told thee what thou should do. Completely surrendered. What would you have me do? What would you have me give? Where would you have me go? Completely. Because what you have, who you are, where you are, it's all due to him. That level of surrenderedness is what God expects of a faithful servant. You must be one with the right spirit. Philippians chapter 2, verse 14. One with the right spirit. And it says, do all things without murmurings and disputings. 15, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights into the world. He recognizes where we are and what we're meant to do, who we're meant to be, the kind of servant we are meant to be in the midst of a perverse, crooked and perverse generation. We must be one with godly testimony. And verse 15 still serves that. Must be blameless and harmless in the midst of all that is. Like the point I made earlier concerning Joshua, it was his testimony, I believe, that convicted the people. His life story, the things where he was coming for, and the challenges that he had overcome, and the testimony of his life. When he said, for me and my household, I have chosen to serve the Lord. They could see it. And much more than anything that will speak, our lives is a greater weapon for sharing the love of Jesus. So one with a godly testimony, then must be diligent. Like I said, the whole of Romans chapter 12 is a good place for us to really study and look at what is required of us as servants, as faithful servants. Must be diligent. Romans chapter 12, verse 11. Must be diligent. Say, I will take it from 10. It said, be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. Not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. Not slothful in business. That's the level of diligence God expects of us. I'm amazed at times when I look at those who work in high-pressured environments, you know, like the banks are. You know, they have targets that they set for themselves. They set for them. Bring in 500 million naira and bring 200 million naira. You understand? And you see them running up and down. How am I going to? You see the level of dedication, maybe driven by fear. I don't know. But you find those who are really, really pursuing that target with the best way they can. I'm asking, do you set targets for yourself in your service for God and pursue it with that level of diligence that we will do your work? Do you? Do I? Also, he must be humble. Sorry to use the word, the pronoun he or she. Must be humble. Humility is essential. Humility must be essential. Romans chapter 12, verse 3, not 23. It says, "For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to." That's where pride comes in. Thinking of yourself more highly than you ought to. But to think soberly, according as God had dealt to every man the measure of faith. Humility is essential for the faithful servant. Also, you must be clear about your service, about your ministry, about your calling. You must be clear. This is what I know I am called to do. It is sweeping the toilet. It is sweeping the, you understand? It is funding the ministry. It is evangelizing. But be clear about what God has called you to do. So you are not running in somebody else's lane. A gift or talent, an ability that he has not deposited with you. Let's read that Galatians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. You will hear what Paul said. It says, "For he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me towards who? The Gentiles." That was his own call, was towards the Gentiles. "And when James, Cephas, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they did what? They gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we may go unto the heathen, and they unto the circumcision." Their lines were clear. Their paths were clear. You must be clear what your calling is, what your vision is, what your ministry is, so that you can run well. It could be effectual running. So we talked about service, what is required of us. We talked about the things that we need to give. We talked about the sacrifices that we need to make. We have asked that, you understand, so many things. But is that where it ends? On my part alone, just doing? Is that where it ends? Will you employ the clerk that we were talking about that you employ? Will he work and work for the first month? He keeps working and working the second month. You don't think that there will be a strike? You don't think that the guy will come and say, "Oh, guy, what is going on? I've been working for the past how many months? There is no salary, sir." So what exactly? Is there anything that God does? Let's look at that. The reward for faithful service. Number one is commendation from God. Let's open to Matthew chapter 25, verse 21. Commendation from God. In the parable of the talent. It said, "His Lord said unto him," those who were able to flourish with that which God gave them, "say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord." So there's commendation. He will commend you. He will appreciate your effort. He will appreciate the sacrifices that you are giving. Secondly, there's material benefit. I won't dwell there, but because we know that is the focus for all of us. There's material benefit. He won't turn, because he said, the Bible is replete with promises of provision. He's a great provider. So that which you are afraid of, he will meet you at the very point of your need. Material benefits is part of what comes with faithful service. Because he sees your heart, he knows you need it, and he will orchestrate things to work in your favor for that need to be met. And also, the blessed presence of God. That's another thing that you have. You know, the team text for last month in Acts chapter 27, when Paul was saying, you know, in the ship that ran aground, he said the presence, he could confidently talk about the presence of God with him and assure them what will happen. That comes with faithful service. When Elijah stood in 1 Kings 17 and said, before whom I stand, there will be no rain for 3 years going. It only comes, that's what faithful service does. The presence of God, the assured presence of God in everything that you do, you will know that he's with you because you are in his will. You are walking in the path that he has ordained for you. You are touching the lives that he has spoken to you about. Then there is the ultimate of all. If you think you have lost it here on earth, 1, 2, 3 did not come to you, but fret not. The ultimate, the crown of glory in heaven awaits you. The crown of glory, the one that is the most important of all, awaits you. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4. It says, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that faded not away. The material things will fade. That's why I didn't want to dwell on it. The material things will fade. Those who were using I drive a Camry 2010. When it first came out, it was like, hey! But now there's Camry 20, say 15 or 16. 17, there's even 17. You look at the design, I say, wow! So you understand, and then you know that was the time of Guinea, and you starch it, and the thing will be looking like newspaper. Now you see, is it Atiku, and you know all sorts of things, they will fade away. The houses that you just drive through these places, and you see those houses, some they are disappearing. They pull them down. Those big, humongous houses in Magodo, they are all gone. Material things will disappear. But the Bible tells us the crown of glory that will not fade. Why don't we strive for that one? The one that will endure for eternity. And eternity has no end. It has no end. And I say, if somebody tells you that you will spend 20, 30 years of your life in America, but you will spend 10 years here in Nigeria, where are you going to be investing all your money? In America, Abby? So that when you go to America, you will enjoy America. And then where are we now investing our time and resources here? When we know that we'll spend eternity in heaven. When it is where we'll spend eternity that we should be making deposits into. Brethren, we need to ask ourselves serious questions. Because I believe that the reason for this is not a mistake. For this theme, because the season we're entering into is the season of the faithful servant. My prayer is that the grace to do that which God is expecting of us, that grace will rest upon each and every one of us in the name of Jesus. Shall we rise?
Preach the Foursquare gospel, the Foursquare gospel. Clear, let the Foursquare message ring. Jesus only Saviour, Baptizer and leader. Jesus the coming King.